Simpson matter. Mr. Simpson is again present before the court with his counsel, Mr. Shapiro, Mr. Cochran, Mr. Douglas, Mr. Bailey, Mr. Blazier, people represented by Ms. Clark, Mr. Darden, and Mr. Gordon. Jury is not present. Counsel, anything we need to take up before the defense calls their first witness? Good morning, Mr. Cochran.
Good morning, Your Honor. I just wanted to indicate for the record that yesterday at about 5 o'clock, I should start off by saying that I had received a call from Mr. Yokelson, I believe on Friday afternoon, regarding witnesses above the 8 or 9 names that I had given him, I think on last Wednesday, or the prosecution. And we did, in fact, get back to him yesterday afternoon and gave him perhaps 20, 24 additional names, which we think will perhaps take us through the next 2 weeks.
Which means we have approximately how many names at this point?
That I've given him, probably somewhere, I haven't counted exactly, Your Honor, but somewhere in the area of about 30, 33, 34. Right. And as I would indicate further, it is, if there are witnesses we're not going to call when I become aware of that list, I'll let the prosecution know and try to always let them have the order. And I think that will expedite this matter so we can move through this trial. I do have some concerns, however, Your Honor, that I'd like to bring to the court's attention. One of our witnesses that we expect to call, hopefully today, depending on how fast we move, is a lady named Carol Connors. And this lady yesterday received a call from a lawyer by the name of Gloria Allred that was entirely inappropriate. First of all, Ms. Carol Connors is represented by a lawyer, and he will be here later today. His name is Ed Peace. I spoke with him last night. He was extremely upset that Ms. Allred would seek to call Ms. Connors, whom he represents, and then proceed to badger her and was screaming at her to the extent, according to Ms. Connors, that Ms. Connors had to hang up the phone. And the reason I wanted to bring this to the court's attention, she was apparently urging Ms. Connors to talk to the prosecution. And I am very concerned for these number of witnesses we have that I don't want to see them harassed. Certainly the prosecution has a right to ask to talk to the witnesses. If the witnesses want to do that, that's fine. We have no problem with that. But I will not stand by as an officer of this court and not at least bring it to Your Honor's attention. And I believe Mr. Peace will be going to the other appropriate state agencies regarding the conduct of this lawyer in calling his client and badgering her like it happened last night. And I just wanted to put that out and put it on the record. I think that it was very unfortunate, and I hope that won't happen again with any of the other witnesses. It's in a search for truth, Your Honor. Witnesses should be able to come to court without fear from anyone or being intimidated or affected by anyone. And I think it would be outrageous if people were deterred from testifying in this case because of the conduct of any of the parties. And so I wanted to bring this to the court's attention.
All right. Thank you, counsel. I'll hear from Mr. Peace when he's available.
He will be here before she testifies, and I'm sure he'll bring it to Your Honor's attention. The other thing is that, as we've indicated to the court, in proceeding with this case, we're ready to proceed and would ask leave to call Ms. Arnelle Simpson. We'd had a conversation back in chambers on Friday, which I indicated the general parameters of her testimony. And if there is any area where I feel that there's a question or whatever, and there is an area where regarding a letter that we gave the prosecution last evening, and this is a letter from Nicole Brown Simpson to Mr. Simpson in 93, which we think is very probative, but it has a specific purpose only. And before we get to that or ask any questions of it, I want to have a 402 hearing, but I don't want to lay the proceedings. That would be the very last question, and we would not, before we got to that, I would ask for a recess, and then we'll have a 402 hearing.
All right.
That's all I would like to do.
All right. Good morning, Ms. Clark.
Good morning, Your Honor. Let me first indicate to the court, assure the court, although it probably does not need the assurance, at no time have the prosecution engaged in any conduct that would tend to harass or intimidate anyone, any witness for either side. We have had no contact with Carol Connor. I certainly have never spoken to Gloria Allred, and if any of the allegations made by counsel are true, which I sincerely doubt, then that is a matter to be taken up at a later point, but it certainly does not involve any conduct on the part of the prosecution. We would never engage in such conduct. It's beyond even thinking. Secondly, Your Honor, with respect to the proposed testimony of Ms. Simpson, the people are requesting that there be an offer of proof. We have no statement from Ms. Simpson. We have no indication at all as to what the parameters of her testimony might be. The proffer of the letter back in 93, I believe, from Ms. Nicole Brown is an indication to me that the intended parameters are very, very broad, and perhaps impermissible in light of the issues that are framed in this case. And rather than have to go through lengthy sidebars and objections that will waste the jury's time, we are asking that the defense be required to submit an offer of proof to this court so that we can see what the boundaries of the testimony proposed by her are. At this time, we have no idea. The only statement we have from Ms. Simpson at this time is very, very brief testimony elicited at the preliminary hearing pursuant to 1538.5 motion made by the defense at that time, which is July of 94. At this time, there's been no statement made by her to the officers. There's been no statement made by her to the defense, which has been proffered to us. So we have no idea what the defense intends to elicit, and I think the court is entitled to an offer of proof to make sure that improper questions are not asked, to make sure that areas are not gone into which are impermissible or improper. And perhaps the defense needs to know what areas the court thinks are proper and improper, or which areas might open doors the defense does not want to open. And a good example of that would be the letter that's been offered so far. But I think that it is clear that in the absence of a statement having been given to the people that will indicate what the boundaries of the testimony are, that the court is entitled to an offer of proof before that witness testifies, and people are making that request.
Mr. Cochran.
I find it particularly ironic, Your Honor, that the prosecution has called some 58 witnesses and took almost 6 months. We didn't try to stop them. This so-called search for truth certainly takes a different turn when the defense gets its chance. Certainly this court, and we talked about this last week, Your Honor, you and I, has an absolute right to ask for an offer of proof, and you did. And I tell you, and you were in chambers that indicated, in the areas that I went into, you said it's absolutely irrelevant and totally permissible. Your Honor, these people, the prosecution does not have a right to take each one of our witnesses and ask what we're going to testify. I mean, they're so insecure about their evidence. Listen, if this is a search for truth, you are going to do the right thing with regard to the evidence. We are experienced lawyers. We're not going to go far afield with this jury. We're going to bring on the areas we know about opening doors. And quite frankly, if there is a question about opening a door, we want a ruling. We want a ruling before we ask the questions. And I've indicated to you we will be doing that. And I've indicated the general areas we'll talk about. I mean, it's preposterous for experienced lawyers to stand here and say, Arnelle Simpson was the person awakened by the police officers, Your Honor, shortly after 5 o'clock on the 13th. I mean, it's preposterous. She was home that evening. I mean, for them to say this is just preposterous because they don't have a report. There is no report. And as I indicated on Friday, when they're at some point later in their careers, when they practice on both sides, they'll understand how things perhaps work better. Now, of course, Ms. Lewis, of course, indicated to me she'd never be on this side, but you have to have a client to be on this side. And, you know, and I just
well,
want
to... Counsel, we don't need to go into
right.
that.
But the point is, Your Honor, I think that we've done this already. I tried to indicate that to the court, and we were very aware of that. And I told you further that both Mr. Shapiro and I and each lawyer who will be taking witnesses and these first witnesses, if there's a question mark in our mind, unlike what happened in the people's case, we will ask to approach the bench and ask some advice on those questions, Your Honor.
All right. Thank you, Counsel.
Thank you, Your Honor.
All right, counsel, the way we will proceed is accordingly. Where there is a witness, where there is no statement available, I will ask and expect an offer of proof. As to the first witness, Arnelle Simpson, this person is well known to counsel on both sides. Her ability to testify to what was going on at the Simpson residence the night of the crime, what occurred that morning, what occurred in the few days afterwards, the demeanor of the defendant, any statements that may have been made by Mr. Shipp. I mean, she is potentially competent to testify to a number of issues that are obvious to me. So I don't think I'm not going to expect an additional offer of proof beyond what we discussed in chambers last week as to Ms. Arnelle Simpson. All right, anything else? All right, let's have the jurors, please.
One question on the issue of the letter that they will attempt to introduce through Arnelle Simpson. Can we have a list of the P's and A's they intend to argue and provide the court?
Can I suggest that there may not be a list, but they could speak with Mr.
Gordon. Mr. Ullman is here. Mr. Gordon, you want to chat with Mr. Ullman?
Sure.
And Mr. Cochran, who is going to do the direct examination of Ms. Simpson? All right. And Mr. Cochran, who comes after Ms. Simpson? Carmelita Durio.
There's the issue of the exclusion order, the court issue. To the Brown family and the victim's family,
far as being excluded from the proceedings when there was testimony being provided by other witnesses that might relate to their...
Excuse me, Ms. Simpson, hold on.
...to their testimony.
We need the jury first.
Okay. Are you interested at all?
Yes. Mr. Cochran? Exclusion of other family members when they're going to be testifying as to the same issues.
Okay. I expect that Ms. Simpson will also be testifying sometime this morning. Being she's in a wheelchair, are you asking Ms. Simpson be mother be moved also?
Anybody who's going to be testifying to the same issues, yes. They should not hear each other's testimony. All right, so they'll be excluded.
Case that there's no law or authority.
And counsel, our lunch recess today will be until 1:30. And let the record reflect that we've now been rejoined by all the members of our jury panel. Morning, ladies and gentlemen.
Morning.
See everybody's well. All right. At this point, Mr. Cochran, you may call the defense's first witness.
Thank you very kindly, Your Honor. Good morning, Your Honor. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen.
Good morning.
Your Honor, the first witness that the defense will call is Ms. Arnelle Simpson.
All right. Ms. Simpson, would you come forward, please?
Arnelle Simpson, A-R-N-E-L-L-E-S-I-M-P-S-O-N.
Good morning, Ms. Simpson.
Good morning.
Ms. Simpson, are you acquainted with the gentleman at the end of counsel table there, Mr. O.J. Simpson?
Yes, I am.
And how are you acquainted with him?
I'm his daughter.
And do you have other brothers and sisters?
Yes, I do.
And tell us about your brothers and sisters, their names and their approximate ages.
Jason, Sydney, and Justin.
And can you tell us approximately their ages?
Jason is 25, Sydney is 10, and Justin is 6.
And you're still young enough that I can ask this. How old are you?
26.
And then you're the oldest of the Simpson siblings?
Yes, I am.
What was your date of birth?
12/4/68.
Something unusual about that particular date?
I was born the same day my dad won the Heisman Trophy.
And now, with regard to your background, have you attended college?
Yes, I have.
Where'd you attend college?
I went to the University of Colorado and then transferred to Howard University in Washington, D.C.
And at some point, did you finish Howard University?
Yes, I did.
When was that approximately?
In 92.
All right, now after you finished college, and Howard University is in Washington, D.C.?
Yes, it is.
Did you then have occasion to return back to Southern California?
Yeah, periodically through the holidays.
All right. And prior to that and after that, did you have occasion to relocate here to Southern California, move back here and live here?
Yes, I did.
When was that approximately?
In 92, September of 92.
And that was after finishing, is that correct?
Yes, it was.
Right. Did there come a time thereafter that you had occasion to move back to the Rockingham residence that we've heard about in Brentwood?
Yes, I did.
Now, had you lived in Rockingham at some time earlier in your life?
Yes, I have.
Do you recall when that was approximately?
Off and on my whole life.
Basically. All right. Well, when you were a young lady, was your father married to your mother?
Yes.
And what's your mother's name?
Marguerite Thomas.
And is she present in court here today?
Yes, she is.
Is she the lady there with the flower on her, the yellow?
Yes, she is.
All right. And when did you first move into Rockingham, if you recall, as a youngster?
I was, I believe, 7 when I first moved in with my mother and father.
And can you move a little closer to the microphone?
Oh, sorry.
No, I want you to pull it closer. There you go. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I missed the last answer. You were approximately 7 years of age?
Yeah, I believe so,
And at that time, was that a home? Was that the family home?
Yes, it was.
And who lived at that house at that time?
My mother, my father, myself, and my brother, and my sister Erin, and she passed.
You had a sister Erin who ultimately passed? All right. But so this was a family home purchased at that time, is that correct?
Yes, it was.
Okay. And how long did you live at Rockingham after you moved in at about 7 years of age?
I lived there until 87 when I graduated from high school.
All right. From high school?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Got to say yes.
Yes.
All right. Now, then after 87, you lived other places, is that correct?
Pardon me?
You didn't live at Rockingham after 87 for a while.
I went off to college.
Okay. Then after now you had finished college, did there come a time in 1993 that you moved back into Rockingham?
Yes, I did.
All right, we tell the ladies and gentlemen of the jury when that was that you moved back into Rockingham.
It was approximately, probably early March of 93.
All right, and what were the circumstances surrounding your moving back? Did you have a conversation with your dad?
Yes, I had asked him if I could move in.
The yes would be appropriate, it seems to me.
Yes.
Okay, you had a conversation with your dad, is that correct?
Yes.
And in that conversation, did the two of you discuss your moving back into Rockingham?
Yes, we did.
Get you know. All right. And was anyone else present during that conversation that you had with him?
Yes.
Who was that?
Paula Barbieri.
And who is Paula Barbieri?
My father's girlfriend.
All right. And where did this conversation take place?
In our TV room at the house.
All right. In which house? You're talking about Rockingham?
360, yeah.
All right. You can tell us, why was it that you decided you'd want to move back at home at that point, just generally?
At the time I was living with my mother, and she had a duplex, and wanted to rent out the place I was staying in. And I'd asked my dad if I could move in, and he said yes.
Well, okay, he said, okay, he indicated yes.
Yes.
Okay, we won't go into the conversation. But, so the reason was you wanted to move from your mother's residence and you wanted to move back home, is that right?
Yes.
Okay. Now, when you lived at Rockingham when you were a youngster, did you have your own room?
Yes, I did.
And did your brother Jason have your own room?
Yes, he did.
All right. At some point after you moved out, did your father remarry?
Yes, he did.
All right. And the rooms that you'd had, who occupied the rooms that you originally had when you were a young person? Did your brothers and your younger brothers and sisters take over those rooms?
Yes, they did.
And that's Sydney and Justin?
Yes.
All right. So when you moved back, or when you wanted to move back, where were you going to move at that point? Which room were you going to move in, if you know?
Because Justin and Sydney were occupying our rooms, Dad built two additional rooms in the back for us so that we would have a place to stay.
All right, so he built two additional rooms. If I were, may I put you on?
There's a diagram that's been previously
marked, and I'd like to, so people's. People 66.
All right, people 66, which is the diagram of the Rockingham residence.
Thank you, Your Honor. As I understand it, this particular exhibit is now in evidence, as I understand.
It is.
Is that correct? Ms. Simpson, with regard to people 66, which purports to be a diagram of the grounds at 360 North Rockingham Avenue, you've seen this diagram before, have you?
Yes, I have.
All right. And you were just describing for the ladies and gentlemen of the jury and the court that your dad had built some additional rooms after his new family had moved into Rockingham. Is that correct?
Yes.
And can you show us, if the court will allow you to step down briefly, and show us where the rooms were that your dad had built for you and your brother, basically, Jason? All right, for the record, Your Honor, Ms. Simpson has indicated two areas on People 66 marked Arnelle's room. She indicates both of those rooms at the court, please.
Yes.
And those are the two rooms that you and your brother Jason could occupy, is that correct?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So after this conversation with your dad and Paula Barbieri, did you have occasion to move back into Rockingham?
Yes, I did.
And in the course of the conversation that you had with your dad, did Paula Barbieri also participate in that conversation?
Yes, she did.
All right. Now, when you moved back into Rockingham, I think you told us that was perhaps around March or so of 1993?
Yes.
Did you have any special arrangements whereby you were going to pay rent or whatever?
Yes, I did.
And what was that?
That I would move in and give my father $50 or $100 a month so that when it was time for me to get ready to leave, I would have money for a down payment for a first and last rent.
Would you get the money back?
No.
You would get the money back from your dad?
If oh, yes, if I were to move, yes.
All right. But did you always pay the $50, $100?
In the beginning, I did, then it kind of slacked off.
All right. But you didn't, you weren't put out at any rate, were you?
No.
All right. Now, so starting then in March of 1993, you moved back into the residence, is that
yes.
correct?
Yes, I did.
Now, I want to ask you a question about the family dogs. Did you have a dog back in the early part of 1993 or dogs at the Rockingham residence?
Yes.
Okay, tell us the names of those dogs.
Chachi and Chubbs.
Okay, now Chachi we've heard about, and is Chachi, is that the black chow that we've heard about?
Yes.
And do you know how long you'd had Chachi approximately?
Oh, goodness. It's been about 9 years.
All right, so he's a 9-year-old dog or
yes.
something like that?
Uh-huh.
All right. And he's the black dog we've heard about, is that
yes.
right? Okay. And you mentioned a new name, Chubbs. Who is Chubbs?
Our other dog that we had.
All right. And what kind of dog was Chubbs?
A chow, a brown chow.
All right. And you know how long you'd had Chubbs prior to 1993?
About 11, 12 years.
Was Chubbs older than Chachi?
Yes.
All right. Did something unusual happen to Chubbs?
Yes, he died.
And were you in and around the Rockingham residence when that happened?
Yes, I was.
And after that, did something unusual happen after Chubbs had died?
Yes.
What was that?
We buried him.
All right. Now, with regard to this, and this dog, you were attached to this dog?
Yes.
And what about the younger children?
Yes.
And at that time, and when did he die exactly?
He died either February, end of February, maybe beginning of March of 93.
All right, at that time, was Miss Nicole Brown Simpson, do you know where she was living at that point?
Yes.
Where was she living?
Gretna Green.
And were you acquainted with that residence?
Yes.
And would you occasionally go over to that residence?
Yes.
How often would you go over to the residence when she lived at Gretna Green?
It was very close, so I would stop by periodically to say hello and see the kids, sometimes do errands with her.
All right. And did you make Miss Nicole Brown Simpson aware of the fact that this dog Chubbs had died?
Yes.
All right, did something happen thereafter?
Yes, she came over.
I'll link it up. Thank you. You may answer.
Yes.
And what happened?
At that point, my father, Nicole, and I proceeded to figure out what we were going to do with Chubbs, and we decided to bury him in the front yard.
He's buried in the front yard of Rockingham?
Of the Rockingham house.
All right. And was this a procedure that took place on the day you found him?
Yes.
Where'd you find this dog?
He was in the pool.
All right. Now, with regard to this procedure that you had where the dog was buried, was he buried in the front yard of Rockingham?
Yes.
All right. And how'd that take place?
We didn't want to give him to anybody because we had had the dog for so long. So Nicole had actually made the decision to bury the dog in the front yard, and she dug a hole in the front yard.
And he's buried in the front yard?
Yes.
Did your father try to dig that hole?
He attempted to.
And what did you see him do, if anything?
He couldn't do it.
Relevant.
Sustained.
I'd like to make an offer with regard to that.
Sustained. Right. 93.
Very well, Your Honor. So Mr. Cole Brown Simpson dug this hole, is that correct?
Yes.
All right. And were the younger children also present at the time?
No, they were not.
Okay, just who was present at the time the dog was buried?
My father, Nicole, and myself.
All right. Now, after that dog, after Chubbs had passed on, did your father have occasion to buy another dog?
Yes, he did.
And what was that dog's name?
Cato.
And so when was Cato bought in relationship to the time that Chubbs died?
Maybe 2 to 3 weeks later.
All right. And your dad bought that dog?
Yes.
All right. And where at that point and thereafter, where would Cato live?
At my dad's house.
Okay, at Rockingham?
Yes.
So how many dogs did you have again at this point?
Two.
So that you have both Cato and Chachi living at Rockingham, is that correct?
Yes.
All right. Would there ever be occasions when Cato would be over or taken over to Ms. Nicole Brown Simpson's residence?
Yes.
All right, and at some point, did she move from the location at Gretna Green to some other location?
Yes.
Do you know when that was approximately?
I believe it was the end of 93.
All right, and did you in any way, were you aware about the time that she moved? Did you participate in that move at all?
No, I did not.
All right, you knew when she moved, is that right?
Yeah.
All right, and that's when she moved to Bundy, is it?
Yes.
Okay. Now, then Cato, you've described for us, was living at the Rockingham residence primarily, is that right?
Yes.
Along with Chachi, is that right?
Yes.
Okay. Would there ever be times when Ms. Nicole Brown Simpson would come by and get either one of the dogs, Cato or Chachi?
Yes.
Well, describe that for us.
She would come by in the mornings and either take the dog over to see the kids or she would run with the dog.
Okay, and which dog would she run with primarily, if you recall?
Cato.
All right. And would she ever run with Chachi?
No.
And why was that, if you know?
Chachi has really bad arthritis.
His arthritis?
Yes.
All right. But Cato, was Cato a younger dog?
Yes.
All right. So she would run with Cato?
Yes.
Would she take Cato with her?
Yes.
All right. And would there be times when Cato would stay overnight over at the Bundy residence?
Yes.
Now, your dad has several cars, is that correct?
Yes.
And what when you moved back in 1993, how many cars did he have at that point in and around the Rockingham residence?
Three.
And we've heard about a black Bentley?
Yes.
Is that one of the cars?
Mm-hmm.
And did he have a white Bronco?
Yes.
And he had another car?
Yes.
And that where's that car?
In the garage.
All right. That's the third car, is that correct?
Yes.
All right. Now, with regard to the Bronco, what family members, if any, would drive this Bronco vehicle that your dad had?
Everybody.
And by everybody, who do you mean?
Myself, my brother, AC, Nicole, my father.
All right, and so we get some new names here. When you say AC, who do you have reference to?
Alan Collings.
Collings, is that C-O-W-L-I-N-G-S?
Yes.
Alan Collings. And is that a friend of your dad's in the family?
Yes.
Okay. And you told us that Nicole would drive the Bronco?
Yes.
And you would drive the Bronco?
Yes.
And when you say your brother, I presume you mean your older brother, Jason?
Yes.
By the way, I may have neglected. Is this your older brother, Jason, in the courtroom sitting next to your mother?
Yes.
The right of your mouth? Now, you have a recollection of seeing Miss Nicole Brown Simpson drive that Bronco from the time that you moved back in over the course of the last couple of years?
Yes.
Do you recall under what circumstances she would tend to drive the Bronco?
Either to take the dogs. At one point, her car was in the shop, or to use the car with Justin and Sydney if they had other kids with them, friends of Justin and Sydney's.
To go out, like, on outings or whatever?
Yeah. Yes.
Have you ever seen times when she had one or both of the dogs inside the Bronco when she took it?
Yes.
Have you seen times when she's had one or both of the dogs in the car?
Yes.
Would there be one dog used taken in the car more often than another?
Yes.
And which dog would she take most often?
Cato.
All right. And the children would also be in the car on occasion?
Yes.
Now, after you moved in March of thereabouts of 1993, would you have occasion to see Mr. Cole Brown Simpson or the children over at Rockingham on times after you moved in March of 1993?
Yes.
Would you describe for the ladies and gentlemen of the jury the circumstances by which you would see her over at the Rockingham residence?
She would come over in the mornings, sometimes to let the kids swim, or she would drop them off while she went running, and I'd watch Justin and Sydney. And she would come over sometimes to pick up her mail.
All right, she had mail that would still come to that residence?
Yes.
All right. If you are aware, you'd been over to the Bundy residence, had you not?
Yes.
Did she have a pool at Bundy?
No.
So the kids like to swim?
Yes.
And there is, in fact, is looking at people 66, a pool area that we've all seen on our jury view at Rockingham, is that correct?
Yes.
Now, would you know the times she was coming over there?
No.
Bringing the kids? All right. And so how would you determine she was there, find out she was there?
I'd wake up in the morning, and sometimes I'd walk outside. She'd be out laying out, and the kids would be in the pool. Or I'd come inside the house, and she'd be in the kitchen. Or we'd be going and passing.
All right. And during this time frame, she and your father were somewhat separated. Is that correct?
Yes.
All right. And would I be correct in assuming that when you first moved back in, his girlfriend at that time was Paula Barbieri?
Yes.
All right. Now, the times that you would see Miss Nicole Brown Simpson over at the Rockingham residence, did that continue on for a period of time after you got back in March of 1993?
Yes.
Now, with regard to your relationship with Miss Nicole Brown Simpson, would you have occasion to ever go over to the Bundy residence?
Yes.
And under what circumstances would you go over to Bundy, ma'am?
To stop by, to say hello, to talk to the kids. On occasion, she would call me to babysit the kids in the morning so she could jog or to take them to school.
And were there occasions that after you moved back into Rockingham that you would babysit the children at Bundy?
Yes.
Now, with regard to your dad, Mr. O.J. Simpson, if you know, were there times when he would spend the nights, this is after you came back in March of 1993, over at the Bundy location?
Yes.
Oh. If she knows. And how do you know that he would spend the night over there? Explain that for the court and jury.
He would call me to see if anybody was at the house. Sometimes call me if they wanted something from the Rockingham house for me to bring over to Nicole's house.
And would there be occasions where you would bring things from the Rockingham house over to Bundy and he would be there?
Yes.
And what kind of things would you bring over there?
Like Justin's Nintendo game or a video.
All right. Did the children have games like Nintendo and other kind of videos at Rockingham?
Yes.
They also have some Nintendos and games also at Bundy?
Yes.
Did you ever have occasion to bring any clothes over for your dad from the Rockingham residence over to Bundy?
Yes.
We're talking, so that we're clear for the time, we're talking about primarily after you'd moved back in, is that correct?
Yes.
And do you recall specifically when the times were that you have had occasion to bring clothes over to your dad, the times he was over at Bundy, if you recall?
Yes.
Tell us about that, please, ma'am.
It was during between 93 and 94, around during the summertime.
The summer of 93?
Yes.
Thereabouts. Did there come a time when you started to see Nicole Brown Simpson and your dad, Mr. O.J. Simpson, start to go out together again?
Yes.
And when was that approximately?
It was probably around the month of March or April of 93.
All right. Was this about the time when you would see her out by the swimming pool and things like that?
Yes.
Okay. And then after he started to see Miss Nicole Brown Simpson again, if you know, did he stop seeing Paula Barbieri?
Yes.
All right. So. And so then once he started seeing Nicole Brown Simpson again, he wasn't then seeing Paula Barbieri. Is that correct?
Yes.
All right. And with regard to the time that Miss Nicole Brown Simpson moved to the Bundy location, did you think that was near the end of 93 or the first of 94? Do you know when that was?
I believe it was the end of 93.
All right. So somewhere around that range. Is
yes.
that right? Okay. So this time frame then that you've described where you would take clothes over to the Bundy location would have been in the summer of 93, and that was a time when your dad was again going out with or dating Miss Nicole Brown Simpson. Is that right?
Yes.
Now, during this time that they were seeing each other, she never moved back permanently to Rockingham, did she?
No.
She moved into the house, did she?
No.
All right. Would there be times when she'd come over, though, and spend some time at the house?
Yes.
And would describe that. Did that continue to happen over a period of time?
Yes.
And did they continue to date, if you will, from the time you've talked about in April or May throughout 93 into 94?
Yes.
And would you see her fairly frequently during that time frame?
Yes.
Sustained.
All right. Well, will you describe for us how often you would see her during this time frame after they started dating?
Almost every day.
And just describe for us a general day, if you can picture for us. We're now talking about after the time that they got back together.
Can you rephrase that?
Okay, certainly I will. The question I was asking was whether or not they tended to see each other at both locations, both Rockingham and Bundy. And I was going to ask you to describe a day when you might see Miss Nicole Brown Simpson at Rockingham, first of all.
She would come over during the summer. At one point, we had all gone to a movie, the whole family. They had thrown a couples party, and she would be over at the house. Or he would be over at Nicole's house, and I would go over there, like I said before, and drop off clothes.
All right. Okay, and so with regard to this time frame, are you sure of the exact dates of the time that Miss Nicole Brown Simpson moved from Gretna Green to Bundy?
I'm assuming end of 93, but no, I'm not correct. I don't know the exact date.
All right. You know that at some point she lived at Gretna Green,
and
you know at some other point she moved to Bundy?
Yes.
All right. Now, with regard to the late summer and the month of August or thereabouts of each year, were you aware of how your dad was employed at that time?
He would start his football season.
All right. Was he a sportscaster of some kind?
Yes.
All right. And when he started his sportscasting, did something unusual happen, or did he have to move on locations in August of 19, strike that? Would he have occasion to move his residence in the month of August or in the late summer?
Yes, he would.
All right. And where would he go during this time frame, if you know, ma'am?
He would move to New York and then travel out of New York.
All right. And to best of recollection, again, what month would that normally be he'd move to New York?
It would usually be between the months of August until January.
All right, and you said he would move to New York. Did he have a residence in New York?
Yes, he did.
And what kind of place did he have in New York?
He had an apartment.
And you've been to that apartment, of course?
Yes.
Now, you described for us that you were attending Howard University in Washington, D.C., is that correct?
Yes.
And so would you have occasion to see your dad or visit your dad when you were in D.C. and when he's up in New York?
Yes.
When you were back there? Would you ever go to the New York apartment?
Yes, often.
Now, During that time frame, after the Ms. Nicole Brown Simpson and your dad started dating again, do you recall whether or not you ever had occasion to see them together in New York at any time?
Yes.
Can you describe that for us?
It was no different than the normal. It would usually be on some of the holidays, sometimes the weekends. It would be easier for me to go to New York as opposed to flying all the way to L.A. from Washington, D.C., so.
All right. So there would be times you would see the family there?
Yes.
And would that include the two minor children also?
Justin, Sydney, yes.
And yourself?
Yes.
Right. Now, when you move back into the house that you described for us in March of 1993, were you given any particular instructions about your role around the house there?
Yes.
And what was that?
That basically I had become the woman of the house, and while he was gone, for me just to make sure that everything was running in the household and to just watch it.
All right, so now as you became the woman of the house, do you recall whether or not in the month of August of 1993, did your dad go into sportscasting or broadcasting and have occasion to go to New York during this time frame?
Yes.
So there'd be periods of time when he wasn't even here in California?
Yes.
And were you the woman of the house?
Yes, that's the reason why he made me the woman of the house.
Right. And as the woman of the house, what kind of things would you do?
Just make sure everything was running as far as the gardener and people coming into the house, regulating it, watching, the cars, just household things.
All right. Well, there was a housekeeper?
Yes, there was.
All right. And would the housekeeper be there on weekends?
No.
So on weekends, you really have to be the woman of the house then, is that right?
Yes.
All right. So you did this in 93 after you moved in, is that correct?
Yes.
And primarily he was traveling and doing his sportscasting work?
Yes.
From August on? And that would last how long? You said it was January?
Yes.
All right, and that's?
Oh, yeah, August to January.
All right, and there's some big football game that occurs toward the end of January called the Super Bowl?
Yes.
All right, is that traditionally in the football season?
Yes.
All right. After that, would he stay in New York, or where would he go at that point, if you recall?
He was in L.A., but he would travel quite a bit, too.
All right. Now, he would travel a lot.
Yes.
And under, you were living, and so I'm not sure we made it clear for the jury, but after you moved back in, you described for us that Mr. Simpson had built rooms for you and Jason, and you described them as Arnelle's room back here.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think I asked which room you moved into. When you moved back in, where did you move, if you recall? May you step down here?
Yes.
Thank you.
I was sitting here.
All right. The room marked Arnelle's room, Your Honor, that's next to Cato, correct, that's next to the room marked Kaylin's room.
Yes, right. To the right of that.
To the right of that, thank you. All right, so that's the room you moved into. So this is the room from which you were the woman of the house, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, you were describing for us that your dad would travel a lot even when there was no football season, is that correct?
Yes.
And would you talk to him about his travel? Would he tell you when he was leaving?
Sometimes.
And do you know why he was traveling, what he was doing during this period of time?
That's vague, counsel.
Yes, counsel's correct. You're correct. Let me rephrase that. Do you know what kind of trips he was taking during this period of time after, say, January of 1994?
Yes.
And what kind of trips were they? Business trips?
Some were business, some were pleasure.
All right. He'd go various places?
Yes.
All right. And he'd do this on a regular basis?
Yes.
All right, let's talk a little bit about your dad's traveling habits as you knew them. And we're talking now for the period after January of 1994. Let's say between the period of January and, say, June of 1994. Have you ever been around when your dad was getting ready to leave for a trip?
Yes.
Can you describe for us any particular things about his getting ready, his packing habits, and those sort of things?
Oh, well.
He would usually do everything last minute.
And you've seen this yourself?
Yes.
And describe that, doing things last minute.
Well, there's always been an ongoing joke within the family that we'd always say, Dad, you have to get ready. And he'd always say, I'll get ready before you will be. And I would always, like, prepare an hour before, and he'll, like, get dressed in the last 15 minutes before we would have to leave.
This is
He's done
true.
This for years.
That's something that you've seen as you were growing up?
Yes.
Right. And so there would always be a race to see who was going to get ready first, but he would start much behind you?
Yeah.
All right. And you've seen that happen over a long period of time, have you?
Yes.
Now, I'd like to shift our attention now. You described for us that when you first came back or talked to your dad about coming back, you'd met a lady by the name of Paula Barbieri, and she was present during this conversation. Is that correct?
Yes.
Had you known her before the time you came over and talked to your dad before you moved back in?
Yes.
And do you recall approximately when it was that you first met Miss Paula Barbieri?
It was in 92.
And under what circumstances, if you recall, did you have occasion to meet her?
When we'd have phone conversations when I was at school, and he told me he had met somebody.
All right, and then you had a conversation, you came west. Did you have occasion to have attend any particular event where you had occasion to formally meet Ms. Barbieri?
Yes.
And what was that occasion?
Paula had thrown my father a birthday party on July 9th, which was yesterday, but in 94.
That's his birthday, July 9th?
Yes.
And this party was in 1992?
Yes.
All right. And is that when you... Did you meet her at that time?
Yes.
All right. And where did this birthday party take place?
At our house.
And the house, you mean, again, the Rockingham residence?
Yes.
That's always the house, right?
Yes.
All right.
Sorry.
Okay. So you... there was a birthday party on July 9th, 1992, his birthday, when you first met her?
Yes.
All right. Now, did you have occasion to discuss with your dad his relationship with Paula Barbieri? You can answer that yes or no.
Yes.
And you talked about those kind of things?
Yes.
And during the time, and since you were an adult during this time, and after the time you moved back into the house, would you have occasion to discuss with your dad various subjects, serious subjects such as relationships?
Yes.
Did you have occasion to discuss with him his relationship with Paula Barbieri?
Yes.
At any time, did you have occasion to discuss with him his relationship with Nicole Brown Simpson?
Yes.
Now, I want to direct your attention now to the week of June 6th, 1994. In that particular week, do you recall whether or not your father was home the entire week, or was he away during part of the time, or what was the circumstances?
What year was this?
The week of June 6th, 1994. Do you recall whether your father went out of town at all that week?
He had been coming and going, yes.
All right. And again, was that like a regular week for him?
Yes.
All right. So you became aware that sometime during that week, he left and went out of town, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. Now, prior to that time, the time we're now talking about, June 6th or thereabouts, there come a time when your dad and Nicole Brown Simpson stopped seeing each other again, if you recall.
Yes.
Was that sometime after Mother's Day of 1994?
Yes.
Around that time?
It's around, Mother's Day.
All right. Now, during the time, you've told us that during the time that Mr. Simpson was seeing Nicole Brown Simpson, he was not seeing Paula Barbieri, is that correct?
Yes.
And after this time when Mr. Simpson, your father, was no longer seeing Ms. Nicole Brown Simpson, did you have occasion to again see Paula Barbieri?
Yes.
And was that after they had broken up with Nicole Brown Simpson?
Yes.
And again, would that be after Mother's Day or so in May of 1994 that you saw Paula again?
Yes.
Did you have occasion to discuss the various things that were taking place in your father's life at that time with him at all?
Yes.
You're somebody he would come and talk with?
Yes.
prior to, strike that. Back to this particular week that we were talking about, the week of June 6, 1994. You described for us that you became aware that your dad went out of town that particular week. Recall that?
Pardon me?
You described for us that your dad went out of town during the week of June 6, 1994. Prior to that, before that June 6th week, do you recall a time that after your dad and Mr. Cochran Simpson no longer dating, that she became sick with pneumonia?
Yes.
You recall that?
Yes.
Was that in the month of May after they had broken up as well? I'm asking.
Sustain. Rephrase the question.
Certainly. When was that? When was that when she came down with pneumonia, if you recall, your best recollection?
Sometime in the month of May.
All right. And tell us what you observed with regard to that. Did you ever see her at the house, the Rockingham residence during that time frame?
No.
All right. Were you aware of her being at the Bundy location?
Yes.
And were you aware of whether or not your father did anything in taking care of her during this time frame? I'm asking.
Oral. Foundation sustained.
With regard to whether or not your father cared for Mr. Cochran Simpson when she had pneumonia, how do you know that? What are the circumstances?
Sustained. Rephrase the question.
Certainly. Did you have occasion to see Nicole Brown Simpson during this period of time when she was supposedly sick?
Yes.
Can you describe that for us and tell us where you saw her?
I saw her once at Justin's graduation, and then I went over to her house one day.
All right, and when you say you went over to her house, you went to the Bundy location?
Yes.
And you became aware that she was sick?
Yes.
And what was her ailment at this time?
She had pneumonia.
And with regard to that, were you aware of whether or not your father did anything or visited her or during this particular period of time?
Yes.
Tell us what you observed in that regard.
He went over to her house one day to help.
Oh, well.
He went over to the house to help her one day with the kids and to bring her some soup and medicine, see if she was okay.
All right. And this was during the period of time after they had broken up and while she was sick. Is that correct?
Yes.
All right. Now, back again to this week of June 6th on this particular week. Did you become aware toward the end of the week, specifically, I guess, around Friday, June 10th, did you become aware of your father coming back to California?
Yes.
Do you recall when you saw him in and around that period of time, June 10th, June 11th, if at all?
I don't believe that I saw him on that day.
All right.
Not in person.
All right. Were you aware he was back in town, Harper?
Yes.
All right. Do you recall whether or not you saw him at all on the Saturday, which would be, I think, the 11th of June?
No.
All right. And on Sunday, June 12th, 1994, did you spend the previous night, the Saturday night, in your residence, in your room there on People 66 as indicated?
Yes.
All right. And did you have occasion on that morning to get up and go someplace?
Yes.
And where did you go at that time?
I went to church.
What church did you go to?
St. Martin's.
All right, that's a church out near in Brentwood there?
Yes.
All right. And after you went to church, what time did you go to church?
I went to church at 10.
And did you have occasion to return home after that?
Yes.
And did you see your father at all that morning?
No.
Were you able to ascertain, do you know where he was at that point?
No.
Do you know he's back in town?
Yes.
All right. How'd you know that?
Because Gigi had told me, the housekeeper, that Dad was coming in town on Friday and that he would be leaving at the end of the week.
All right, so you had a conversation with the housekeeper?
Yes.
And her name is Gigi?
Yes.
All right. Her last name is Guarin?
Yes.
Is that G-U-A-R-I-N?
I believe
Guarin?
So.
All right. So you went to church and you came back home, and after you went to church, did you have occasion to go out?
Yes.
And were you out pretty much the whole day?
Yes.
And now do you have a car?
Yes.
A vehicle? And what kind of vehicle did you have?
A Saab.
And what color is it?
Black.
And what year is it?
94.
When did you get that car?
In 93.
Did you have that car when you came back to the Rockingham residence, or did you get it after you got there, or when did you get it, if you recall?
Can you repeat that?
Certainly. Did you have that car when you moved back in with your dad?
Yes.
In March of 1993?
Yes.
All right. Had that car been a graduation present for you?
Yes.
All right. And so where was that car
Where did you traditionally park that car when you were home at the residence? Can you show us that?
Yes.
Again, at the first admission?
Yes.
She's looking again at people 66, Your Honor.
Where this red dot is.
All right. She's pointing toward a red dot on people 66, and it's above the words driveway.
Yes.
On the diagram. And you parked your car traditionally there, is that correct?
Yes.
And if you can show us, was there a place on that diagram where the Bentley was normally parked? And that's the black Bentley you talked about earlier?
Right here.
All right, and that would be right in front of your car, and she's pointing to an area, Your Honor, above drive, and the words driveway on people 66.
Yes, to the left of the red dot.
Left of that. And left of the red dot. Is that where you parked your car normally, where the Bentley was parked?
Yes, usually we both parked our cars in this right here.
All right. Oh, in that
in
little
this, you know,
kind of inset area?
Yeah.
All right.
Yes.
There's both of you try to park your cars in that location?
Yes.
And the Bentley, as I understand your testimony, would be in front. Is that correct?
Yes.
All right. So on when you left the house on Sunday, June 12th, after you'd come back from church, how'd you leave? Did you leave in your car or how'd you leave?
I left in my car.
All right. And you did not return until what time?
Approximately around between 12:30 and 1.
And is that a.m.?
Yes.
All right. Had you been to a movie or something like that?
Yes.
All right. And you returned home about 12:30 or 1. Is that
yes.
Correct? When you returned home, you didn't see your dad, did you?
No.
All right.
It'll
did
stand.
You see? Did you see your dad?
No.
And were you aware of whether or not he was going to go out of town? Again?
Yes.
And if you can just tell us, how did you know that?
Prior to Gigi telling me.
Sustained. Right. Answer stricken, jury's to disregard that.
Right. So you knew of it only from talking to someone else, but you didn't know yourself. Is that
yes.
Right? Okay. Well, I'm asking, Your Honor, Justice Foundation.
Sustained.
All right.
I mean, overruled. Proceed.
Thank you, Your Honor. Now, so you returned home, and was anyone at home when you returned home after 12:30 on now June 13th, 1994?
Yes.
And
yes.
Who was home?
Cato.
All right. Anybody else that you're aware was there?
No.
I think we know who she's talking about, but since we have two Catos here.
Certainly,
oh, I'm
yes.
Sorry.
Yes, well.
Cato Catoman.
Cato, Cato the human being?
Yes.
Cato Catoman. All right. And when you returned home, where did you go at that point, if you recall?
To my room.
All right, and that's Arnelle's room, is that correct?
Yes.
All right, and then do you know about, did you at some point go to sleep?
Yes.
And you know what time approximately you went to bed and went to sleep?
It had to have been around 1 o'clock, between 1 and 1:30.
When you returned home, did you notice anything unusual at all?
No.
About the residence? Now, if you went to bed and went to sleep about 1:30 or thereabouts, there come a time that you were awakened on the morning hours of June 13th, 1994.
Yes.
Describe for the court and jury the circumstances that you were awakened, ma'am, if you recall.
I was awakened around between 5 and 5:30 by two gentlemen knocking at my door.
And these gentlemen knocking at your door, what did they say, if you recall?
They were knocking on my door, and they said that they had been outside ringing the bell and that they needed to speak with somebody who lived at the house.
All right. I presume, having been in the bed, you were attired in your pajamas or whatever?
Yes.
All right. Did you get up at that point?
Yes.
And then tell us what happened at that point.
They had told me that they needed to get in touch with my father and if I knew where he was.
All right, and what did you say in response to that?
I said that he wasn't home, but I didn't know where he was, but I knew how to get in touch with him.
All right, and then what happened after that?
We left out of my room, and I went to get my phone book to get in touch with somebody who would know where my dad was.
And when you say you went to get your phone book, I presume you didn't have your phone book with you at that point.
No, it wasn't.
And now I want you, with the court's permission, did you go to some location to get your phone book?
Yes.
All right. And you were talking to two men, were you?
Yes.
And these two people, were they Los Angeles Police Department detectives?
Yes.
And do you know their names now?
I believe Phillips and Lang.
All right, and can you describe the person you think is Lang for us?
Lang would be the salt and pepper. He has more hair on him, and I think Phillips is the one with the mustache and the bald head.
You may have them reversed. Is the one, there was one had a bald head?
Yeah.
All right, let's call him Lang.
Oh, okay.
And the Phillips, the other one you said was, describe him again?
The salt and pepper hair, older, bigger build.
All right. Let's, for the time being, call him Phillips.
Okay.
Right. Now, did you have we have occasion then, you step down, and I want you to show the jury and the court the route that you took as you sought to get this number so you could try to find your father. You can step all the way down if you want.
You want me to do what?
The question is, can you look at this diagram, and we won't block the jurors, and draw with the pointer there the route that you took as you went to get your book to get the number to call, look at your dad?
Okay, out of here. This way.
All right, Your Honor, let me show you what you're doing. She's leaving, Your Honor, the area marked Arnelle's room, and she walks west to an area with some stairs. She goes up the stairs. Proceeds past the pool. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
All right. She went around the north side of the house to an area marked driveway again on People 66. And you went to an area marked entrance. Now, is that the entrance to the Rockingham residence?
Yes.
And what'd you do when you got to that entrance, ma'am?
I went over here to the kitchen, through the kitchen to the phone here, and then walked through here to get to my car.
All right, let's back up for a moment. When you got to the front door of the residence there, did you have to do anything before you got inside that residence?
I had to turn the alarm off.
There was an alarm on?
Yes.
And you turned the alarm off, is that correct?
Yes.
Now, when you walked this route you just described for the court and jury, was anyone accompanying you at that point?
Yes.
Who with?
The two detectives.
Two people we described earlier?
Yes.
Lang and Phillips?
Yes.
All right. And did you walked around the house and came to the front, and you took the alarm off before you went inside?
Yes.
All right, let me ask you specifically, did you ever at any time walk from your residence here, where Mark Arnell's room, and go through some door here at the back of the house?
No.
When the alarm is on, is that possible?
No.
You can't go in that way, is that right?
No.
The alarm keypad is where?
In the front of the house.
So you went around to the front of the house and turned off that alarm, and then these two detectives came in behind you, is that correct?
Yes.
And you described for the jury that you went into the kitchen area, is that correct?
Yes.
They were still with you?
Yes.
Then after being in the kitchen area, you left to go some other place?
Yes.
Why'd you leave the kitchen area to go outside?
To get my phone book out of the trunk of my car.
All right, and there is a door, it's indicated, Your Honor, and the area is not marked kitchen, but there's a door on the side of the house above the garage area that she, Mrs. Simpson is indicating she went outside.
On the west side of the house, approximately, 2/5 of the way up from the bottom of the diagram.
Very good, Your Honor. And you went outside, and where did you go?
To my car.
And that's the black Saab you described?
Yes.
And what did you get out of your car, if anything?
My phone book.
Okay, and then did the detectives come with you?
Yes.
Now, while you're taking this route or whatever, do you have any conversation with those detectives at all?
Yes.
And again, will you tell us, and you may resume the seat, court, please. Which detective did you speak with, if you recall?
I spoke with, I'm confused with the names.
Okay, describe them.
The one with the mustache and the bald head.
All right, well, that's what we're going to call Lang.
Lang.
Okay. And during that period of time, what did you say to Detective Lang?
I had asked him that I really needed to know what was happening because I was nervous, and he needed to tell me what was going on.
All right. And did he respond to you what was going on?
Yes.
What did he say to you?
He had told me that Nicole, that I know Nicole Simpson, and I said yes, and he said that she had been murdered and that there was somebody else with her.
And where were you when Detective Lang told you that?
Right outside in the back of my car.
This is after you'd come to the kitchen and gone out to get the day book?
Yes.
When you heard that, how'd that make you feel?
I immediately started crying, and I had asked him, are you sure that it was Nicole? And he said yes, and I said, I don't, basically I was just shocked. I couldn't believe it. I didn't know what to do.
All right. If you know, was the other detective standing close to you at the time that Detective Lang told you this, or do you know where he was?
He was inside the house.
He'd remained inside the house when you came outside for your daybook?
Yes.
Before we go back inside the house and after this conversation, were there any other detectives you saw around there at that point?
Yes.
And at what point did you see them?
After I'd come back inside the house. And
right. Do I understand that initially when you first were awakened and walked around, you only saw the two, is that correct?
I saw three.
Okay, you saw another one?
Yes.
Where'd you see the third one?
The third one was in front of Caitlin's room.
Caitlin's room?
Yeah.
Can you describe that person, or do you know that person's name now?
Yes.
What's that person's name?
Mark Furman.
And what was he doing in front of Caitlin's room, if you could describe for us what you saw?
They were talking.
All right. When you walked that route past Caitlin's room, were they talking at that point?
Yes.
All right, so you walked past them.
Yes.
And did you ever see a fourth detective when you were on your way up to the front?
Yes.
And where was that fourth detective?
He was further. Can I show
yeah.
you?
Yeah, you can show us if that's okay with the court.
Yes.
Like over in this area.
This is in the area that's
like here.
It appears to be the patio area adjacent to the pool.
Thank you, Your Honor. And do you know that person's name? Was that Van Adder?
Yes.
Detective Van Adder?
Yes.
All right. Now, did you see Van Adder, Detective Van Adder, at that location when you were walking up the first time?
Mm-hmm.
All right. So, is that a yes?
Yes, sorry. All
right. Okay. So, as I understand it, then, you left your residence, and as you walked, you saw Mark Furman having a conversation with Cato Caitlin.
Yes.
Were they inside the room or outside the room?
Cato was standing in his doorway, and Mr. Furman was standing outside the door.
All right. You walked up those stairs, and as you proceeded on your way, heading kind of northbound on the property, you saw Detective Van Adder somewhere in the patio area by the pool. Is that right?
Yes.
All right. And then you continued on with Lang and with Phillips. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. Now, after you got your daybook out of the back of your vehicle, did you have occasion to go someplace at that point? Did you go someplace?
Yes.
And where'd you go?
I went back inside the house into the kitchen.
All right. And when you got back in the kitchen, tell us what happened at that point.
Then I had called Kathy Randa.
And let me stop you there. Who is Kathy Randa?
My father's assistant.
All right. And you called Kathy Randa. And why did you call her?
To find out where my father was.
All right. And did you ascertain that?
Yes.
And after you found out where he was, did you communicate that to any of the police officers, if you recall?
Yes.
Did you tell, which of the two did you tell? Do you remember you told Lang or Phillips, or who'd you tell?
I believe I told both of them.
Okay. Tell them both?
Yes.
And you tell them he was in Chicago?
I didn't know where he was, but I knew he was out of town.
All right. And after you found out where he was, you found out from Kathy Randa where he was?
Yes.
Right. And you then told him where he was?
Yes.
All right. And you were, now at this point, in your kitchen area there, tell the jury who all was present.
Lang and Phillips.
All right. At this point, you didn't see Van Adder or Furman, is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. What did you next see happen with regard to the kitchen area and the phones therein?
I called Kathy and told Kathy that I had some really bad news. And then I started to cry, and I handed the phone over to, I believe, Lang, and then they had a conversation.
All right, so when you say they, you mean Detective Lang and
Kathy Randa.
Kathy Randa had a phone conversation?
Yeah.
After that, and again, when you say Lang, do you mean the one with the with less hair on the top and the mustache?
Sustained,
yes.
Leading,
all right,
counsel.
All right. When you say Lang, can you describe that person?
The one, the guy with the mustache and hair loss. The one with the bald head.
All right. Okay, so then after this conversation, after Lang had concluded the conversation with Kathy Randa, did you hear or see one of the police officers place a phone call?
Yes.
And did that take place how soon after the conversation with Kathy Randa?
Can you repeat that question then?
Okay. At the time the conversation concluded between Lang and Kathy Randa, how soon was another phone call made in that kitchen area or wherever?
There wasn't a conversation, not on, by the detectives.
Okay.
We waited.
Okay, you waited.
Yes.
Did you at some point become aware that one of the detectives, Phillips or one of them, placed a call to your father?
I believe that Kathy had called, said that she can get in touch with my father, and my father called the house.
All right. You think he called the house?
Yes.
All right. Do you know whether or not, whenever the phone call came in, whether your dad, who did he speak to at that point, if you recall? One of the detectives or you or what?
He spoke with one of the detectives.
All right. Do you recall which detective it was that he spoke with?
I don't recall that.
Could you hear, you could hear one side of the conversation, could you?
Yes.
You could hear what the detective was saying?
Yes.
And do you recall which detective it was at this point?
No, I don't recall which detective it was.
It was one of those two?
Yes.
Either Lang or Phillips, is that correct?
Yes.
All right. And at this point, were you pretty upset?
Very.
You were crying?
Yes.
Were you distraught?
Yes.
And so you heard the conversation between, what you heard what the detective said, is that correct, ma'am?
Yes.
And at some point during that conversation, did you have occasion to speak to your dad, Mr. O.J. Simpson?
Yes.
How did that happen?
The phone was passed over to me, and my father had asked me what was going on, and I said, Dad, Nicole is dead. She's not here with us anymore. And he said, I'm not.
All right. Let me rephrase that. The detective, you heard the detective saying something into the phone, is that correct?
Yes.
And then the phone was passed over to you at some point?
Yes.
And did you recognize the voice of the person on the other end of the phone?
Yes.
Without telling us what that person said, was that your dad?
Yes.
You recognize his voice?
Yes.
And how did he sound to you at that point?
Very upset, emotional. Confused.
All right. Did you then have a conversation with your father?
Yes.
How long approximately did that conversation last?
About 5 minutes at the most.
Were you still also very upset?
Yes.
You know what this would be?
Yes. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take our mid-morning recess. Please remember all my admonitions to you. We'll stand in recess for 15, and Ms. Simpson, you may step down. Come back in 15 minutes, please. All right. Let's have the jurors, please. Deputy McNamara. Let the record reflect that we've been rejoined by all the members of our jury panel. And Ms. Arnelle Simpson, would you resume the witness stand, please? All right, just pull the microphone close to you, please. And Mr. Cochran, you may continue.
Thank you very kindly, Your Honor. You okay?
Mm-hmm.
All right. Now, Ms. Simpson, just before the break, if we took our break, we're talking about the brief five-minute conversation that you had with your dad on the phone. And you described for us how he appeared distraught in his remarks to you. Is that correct?
Yes.
And how were you at this time?
Upset, emotional, crying.
Now, with regard to your conversation with the detective, which I think you said was Lang, describe for us what he said to you exactly during this time frame. What did Lang say to you about Nicole Brown Simpson's death, et cetera?
He had said to me that Nicole had been murdered and that there was another body with her.
And do you recall him saying anything else to you at that time?
No.
All right. So after he'd made this statement and after the phone had been passed to you by the detective and you spoke with your dad and you described how he was, what then happened after that, ma'am?
Can you say that
What again? Happened after that?
After?
After you finished talking with your dad. I'm sorry.
Oh, at that point I'd asked if Nicole's mother knew. And he said, no, do you know how to get in touch with her?
Okay, now when you said you asked that, who did you ask that of?
To Lane.
All right. And when he asked you whether or not you knew how to get in touch with her, what did you say?
I said yes.
All right, and then what happened at that time, if anything?
I had called Judy Brown.
All right. You knew you had her number?
Yes.
All right. Had any of the detectives at that point asked you at all about the Browns at all?
No.
All right, you were the first one to bring that up?
Yes.
All right. And after you brought it up, you then got Miss Judy Brown on the phone?
Yes.
And did you talk to her or try to talk with her?
Yes.
Describe for us what you did and what you said at that point.
I called Judy and I said, Judy, I have some really bad news for you. And I attempted to tell and I started crying and I gave the phone over to Lang.
All right. So you couldn't complete this conversation?
No.
You were still distraught, is that correct?
Yes.
All right. So you then handed the phone back to the detective, and did you hear his conversation to Miss Judy Brown?
I was too emotional then. I wasn't really listening to what he was saying.
All right. But at any rate, you knew they had a conversation, is that correct?
Yes.
All right. This all took place in the kitchen area that's you've been describing for us?
Yes.
All right. You're still in the kitchen area?
Yes.
Now, during this time frame, have you seen any of the other officers? You've described for us, I think, Lang and Phillips and you being in the kitchen area. Have you seen any other detectives inside the house at this time?
No.
All right. Then at some point, the conversation with Miss Judith Brown, did that conversation conclude?
Yes.
And then what happened after that?
Then the detective told me that I needed to go pick up Justin and Sydney, that they were at the police station.
And your two minor siblings, is that right?
Yes.
And after you were told that, what did you do, if anything?
I told the detective that I couldn't go do this by myself, that I had to call somebody to help me.
All right. And did you call somebody then or at some later time?
I called at later time.
Okay. Now, how were you dressed when you were in the kitchen area? How were you attired at that point?
I had on pajamas.
All right. This is because you just got up.
Yes.
Right? Okay. Did you remain in the kitchen after they had indicated you should pick up your brother and sister?
No.
All right. Where did you go, if you recall?
I went to go into my room, and the phone rang then.
Went back to your room?
Yes.
Okay. And when you got there, the phone rang?
Yes, but it was on my way to the room, to my room.
All right. Did you answer the phone?
Yes.
And who was it?
My father.
All right. Did your father call back?
Yes.
And then you had this would be a second conversation with him?
Yes.
All right. You can't tell us what was said, but how did he appear to you during this conversation? What was his demeanor?
He was very upset. He was crying. He was saying, Arnelle, I don't understand.
Well, you can't tell us what?
Sorry. Okay. He was very upset and emotional.
All right. Had you ever, at any time in your then 25 years, heard your father sound like that?
No.
This conversation, where did you take that phone? Where did you take that to have that conversation?
I had the conversation in the TV room.
All right, the TV room is a room that's, we've been to the residence, it's off the, well, you tell us, where's the TV room?
I guess it would be somewhere around here.
All right, Grandma, she's pointing to the center of the area of the house, to the right of the area marked entrance. It's in a line for you come in the front door, but further back in the house, is that correct?
Yes.
And that's is that a room that has like three TVs in a wall?
Yes.
All right.
All right, Mr. Cochran, let me see you and Mr. Clark for just a moment without the court report, please. All right, thank you, counsel. Mr. Cochran, you may proceed.
Thank you, Your Honor.
We're talking about describing the three TVs in the TV room.
Thank you, Your Honor. The conversation, the second conversation you had with your dad was in the TV room. Is there a phone there in?
Yes.
Okay, and you were on your way back to your room when the phone rang and you then picked it up?
Yes.
All right. Describe his demeanor. Now, you can't tell us what he said, but what did you tell your dad at that time with regard to what the police had told you?
Sustained.
Let me ask you another way. Did you say something to your dad during this conversation?
Yes.
And in the course of talking to your dad, did you tell your dad what, like, let me finish the question. Did you tell your dad what the police had told you? I said yes or no?
Yes.
And you can't tell us what he said. Did you tell him everything the police had told you?
Yes.
And after you finished talking with your dad and telling him what the police had told you, he was upset and distraught as you described?
Yes.
All right. Now, how long did this conversation last, the second conversation with your dad?
It was 5 to 10 minutes.
And on this occasion, did he talk to any detectives at all, if you know?
No.
Did he remain distraught throughout the entire conversation?
Yes.
Were you able to ascertain during that conversation when your dad was coming home?
No.
You knew he was out of town at that point?
Yes.
Did you become aware at some point that he was coming home immediately?
Yes.
And when was that?
Later on in that morning.
All right. All right, so then after this conversation with your dad, the second one, did you then, that conversation was concluded at some point, is that right?
Yes.
And where did you next go?
I went into my room to change and I made some phone calls.
All right, so you went back to your room?
Yes.
And did you change clothes?
Yes.
All right. And who did you call at that point?
I called AC, Al Collings. I called my mother. I called my brother, and I called a friend.
All right. And these calls you all made from your room, is that correct?
Yes.
That was your phone?
Yes.
When you talked to your dad this second time, had the subject matter of the children and their whereabouts, had that come up at all?
Yes.
So the two of you talked about that?
Yes.
Again, with regard to the children, did you share with your dad what the police had told you about the location of the children?
Yes.
Did you tell your dad that you were going to get the kids?
Yes.
And so when you went back to your room, you made these phone calls you've described for us, is that right?
Yes.
And you mentioned calling a Mr. Cowlings, is that correct?
Yes.
And why did you call him?
Because I wanted him to go with me to go pick up Justin in Sydney.
All right. Did you talk to your brother, Jason?
Yes.
And did you mention talking to a friend named Jonah?
No.
Did you talk to a friend?
Yes.
Point? All right. Now, at some point after you finished these conversations, you were dressed. What happened after that?
I came back inside the house, and at that time, AC was on his way in. AC spoke with two of the detectives, and then the detectives told AC where the kids were, and then him and I went to go pick up Sydney and Justin.
All right, so now that we're clear, AC is Mr. Alan Cowlings that you described for us.
Yes.
And he did arrive, and about what time was it that he arrived in the early morning hours?
Had to have been around 6:30. A quarter to seven.
All right. In the best of your recollection, what time had the police first come to your door, if you know?
Between 5 and 5:30.
A.M.
A.M.
Now, when you left the kitchen area on the way through the family room area and had the second conversation with your dad, did you see any other police officers in the house at that time?
No.
When you went back to your room, did you see any police officers outside at that point?
Yes.
And describe for the jury what you saw and where they were located.
I saw Furman and Cato.
Where were they?
Standing a little bit further from the room that Cato was staying in.
In which direction, Ms. Simpson? You can step all the way down if you need.
Right, around here.
She's now indicating an area, Your Honor, near the stairs or near the area depicting the stairs, partially in the patio area.
Appears to be the southernmost portion of the pool patio area.
Yes. And they were standing at that location?
Yes.
They still appear to be talking?
Yes.
They were still outside, is that right?
Yes.
All right. Did you see Detective Van Adder?
No.
All right. When you left out of the house, did you leave Lang and Phillips inside your father's house?
Yes.
Was there anybody else at home at that time?
No.
All right, and how long were you out at in your room getting ready and making these phone calls?
10 to 15 minutes.
And after you'd gotten dressed and finished the phone calls, you came back inside the house?
Yes.
And what route did you take coming back into the house, if you recall?
Through the back door.
All right, and had you opened that back door yourself when you went out?
Yes.
After you'd finished the conversation with your dad in the family room, you went out through the back door?
Yes.
Can you point on the diagram again, people 66, where that back door is? All right, she's indicating, Your Honor, again, on the easternmost part of the residence, an area, which I presume appears to be a door leading from the residence.
Yes.
And so at that point, there were only two officers left in the house at your
Yes.
Home. All right. Now, after you finished and you came back in after 10 or 15 minutes, where did you go when you before you met Mr. A.C. Collings?
Back to the kitchen.
Went back in the kitchen area?
Yes.
When you got back there, who was present?
Nobody was in the kitchen.
All right. Where were the detectives at that point, if you know?
I didn't know.
All right, you just went back in the kitchen. You were by yourself at this point?
Yes.
Did you see Lang?
No.
Did you see Phillips?
No.
Where was Furman at that point, if you know?
In the back, speaking with Cato.
Still in that same area that you described him?
Yes.
Where was Van Adder at that point?
I don't know.
All right. And then how long did you stay in the kitchen before you became aware of Mr. Cowling's presence?
Very shortly, right after that.
He appeared?
In the kitchen.
And you saw him in the kitchen?
Yes.
All right, did you go and find a detective at that point? Or did a detective
no,
come in there?
No.
What happened?
One of the detectives came back inside the kitchen.
Okay, do you remember which one it was? Can you describe it?
I believe it was Lang.
All right. And when he came back in, was there a brief conversation between Detective Lang and Mr. A.C. Collins?
Yes.
All right. Does the subject matter of that conversation deal with picking up the children?
Yes.
All right, and then how much time passed before you left the Rockingham residence that morning to go and try to pick up your brother and sister?
Between 15 and 20 minutes.
All right. About what time was it then, by now, that you were about ready to leave?
It had to have been around 7 o'clock, 7:15.
Again, these are your best estimates?
Yes.
All right, did you and Mr. Collins leave at that point?
Yes.
And did you go to the police station?
Yes.
And did you arrange to pick up the children?
Yes.
You did pick them up?
Yes.
After you picked the children up, what did you do then?
We went back to 360 North Rockingham.
To your home, Rockingham?
Yes.
Gotta keep your voice up.
Thanks.
Okay. So, do you know about what time it was that you actually left Rockingham to go pick up the children?
It had to have been around 7 o'clock, maybe 7:15.
All right. Now, when you left, you've already described for us that the housekeeper was not there at that point, is that right?
No.
Was there any other adult other than Cato Kalin in and around 360 North Rockingham at the time that you left, other than the police officers?
No.
And when you left, well, there were four police officers there, Mr. Cato Kalin was somewhere around there, is that right?
Yes.
Did you see the four detectives and where they were when you left?
No.
So now you return back to Rockingham. About what time is it now?
Between 7:15 and 7:30.
All right. And when you come back, is it you and the children and Mr. Collins?
Yes.
All right. And where do you go when you come back in?
To the kitchen.
And do you see anybody inside the kitchen?
No.
All right. Do you see the detectives when you get back?
Not right away, no.
All right, at some point after you get there, do you see some or all of them?
Yes.
Okay. Tell us when you first observe a detective or detectives after your return from picking up the children at the police station.
I was in the kitchen and one of the detectives have come through the kitchen.
All right. You were in there with the children?
Yes.
And with AC coming?
Yes.
All right. Which detective was it, if you recall?
I don't recall.
All right. Is one of them?
Yes.
Okay. Did you have some conversation with him?
No.
All right. Did you see other detectives while you were back in your kitchen?
Yes.
And when was that?
In the period that I was trying to entertain the kids.
All right. You were trying to keep the children occupied, were you?
Yes.
And what were you doing?
Sydney had fallen asleep on the couch and Justin was playing Nintendo, so I was playing with him.
There had been no mention of the tragedy that happened, obviously.
No.
All right. So, what happened after that as you tried to entertain Justin?
One of the detectives, I don't recall which one it was, told us that we had to leave the house.
Had to leave your own house?
Yes.
All right. You don't recall which one it was?
No.
Where were you when he told you you had to leave?
In the kitchen.
And when you were told that, what'd you do at that time, if anything?
At that point, I went to speak with AC.
All right.
Mr. Collins.
Okay. Mr. Collins was somewhere in the house?
Yes.
All right. And did you have a conversation with him?
Yes.
Where did you have that conversation?
In the kitchen.
After that, was some decision made with regard to the children?
Yes.
Had you, at some point that morning, received a call from Mr. Deetha Brown?
Yes.
She called you back?
Yes.
And when was that?
After we had picked up the kids and during the period that we were just in the kitchen.
So you were back at the location?
Yes.
And she called?
Yes.
You talked to her on the phone?
Yes.
Did the subject matter of the children come up during that conversation?
Yes.
And there was a conversation with you and Judetha Brown?
Yes.
At some point that morning, was a decision made to transport the children out to Judetha Brown's home in Orange County?
Yes.
And who was to do that?
Mr. Collins.
All right. Did he do that at some point?
Yes.
Was this after the police had said you had to leave the house?
Yes.
So he then left, is that right?
Yes.
When you got back home from the police station and picking up the children, did you see Cato Kalin at that point?
Yes.
And where was he?
He was in the bar area.
The bar area is generally where, and you might use the diagram again and use your pointer, as make it in relation to the TV room that we just previously described and the kitchen. Sure. She's again indicating an area in the southernmost portion of the residence area, the bar area, not far from where that door is that you go out.
Thank you.
Thank you, Your Honor. And what was Mr. Kalin doing as he was seated in that bar area, if you recall?
Speaking with a detective.
Which detective was he speaking with, if you recall?
I believe it was Van Anner.
All right. Did you hear what they were saying?
No.
All right. So Mr. Collins leaves with the children. You're there now, and Cato's there. Is that right?
Yes.
And the four detectives are still somewhere around there, is that right?
Yes.
Okay. What happens after that?
AC took the kids and took them to Laguna, and I went into my room.
You went back to your room?
Yes.
Okay. And once you got to your room, what'd you do then, if anything?
I was gathering my things, and the phone rang.
All right. You got another phone call?
Yes.
All right. Was your brother Jason there by this time?
No.
Was it your brother on the phone?
No.
Who called you then?
My father.
All right. And you talked to your father again?
Yes.
This would be the third conversation with your dad that morning, is that right?
Yes.
And again, you can't tell us about that conversation, but in talking to your father and hearing his voice, would you describe for the court and jury again his demeanor, how he seemed and how he appeared to you at that point?
Upset, out of control, distraught. Emotional.
Had you ever in your life ever heard him like that before?
No.
Again, without telling us about that conversation, did the subject matter of that conversation concern when he was coming back to California?
Yes.
Was that when you found out when he was coming back?
Yes.
Did you ascertain he'd be coming back as soon as possible?
Yes.
On that date, June 13th?
Yes.
Was in that conversation that you found that out?
Yes.
How long did that conversation last?
5 to 10 minutes.
Were you able to tell him during that conversation anything with regards to the kids, the children, because you now have the children, right?
Yes.
Did that subject matter come up?
Yes.
And would I be correct in assuming that in that conversation, he was still in Chicago, was he?
Yes. Dead?
Was anyone else present during that conversation other than you?
No.
Now, after that conversation, did you then get ready to leave the premises?
Yes.
Had you made some arrangements of some place to go?
Yes.
All right. And by what time was it by now, if you recall? Your best recollection.
7:45, 8 o'clock.
All right, and what happened after that, after you? Did you then leave the premises in your own car?
No.
Okay, did somebody come and pick you up or take you?
Yes.
Somebody else came then?
Yes.
And who was that?
My brother, Jason.
And that's the gentleman we described earlier. That's your sibling, is that correct?
Yes.
Now, you are the oldest of the children?
Yes.
Okay, and he's next in line to you,
yes.
Right? He came, and did he come in the house also?
No.
You went outside the way he was?
Yes.
He did not come inside?
No.
And with regard to your car, did you try to take your car?
Yes.
And what happened when you said you wanted to take your car?
They told me that I wasn't allowed to take my car.
So although you had to leave, you couldn't take your car, is that right?
No.
So how did you finally leave the premises?
With my brother, Jason.
So when Jason came, he was able to take you someplace, is that correct?
Yes.
And where did you go?
I went over to a friend's house.
And how long did you stay at this friend's house, if you recall?
The majority of the day.
Now, did there come a time when you had occasion to also speak with your mother, Ms. Marguerite Thomas, on that date?
Yes.
Did you talk to her at all while you were still at the Rockingham residence?
Yes.
And where were you when you talked to her and made that call?
In my room.
All right. Was that just before you left or at some earlier time?
Some earlier time.
It was the time before you went to get the children?
Yes.
All right. You told her what had happened?
Yes.
Did you have occasion to talk to her later on when you went to your friend's house?
Yes.
Did you stay at your friend's house pretty much all day?
Overruled. Well, then you need to object in a timely manner. Proceed.
Tell us what you did after you were at your friend's house.
I was at my friend's house the majority of the day. I had called Kathy at some point. I fell asleep, woke up. I was watching TV, just talking, crying.
All right, so you spent, how long did you stay at your friend's house?
If you until recall, about 5:36.
Did the police, when the police told you had to leave your house, did they tell you when you could come back home?
No.
So later in the evening, after 5:30, did you find out whether or not you could come back home?
Yes.
All right. Was it after then that you left your friend's house and did you then come back to the Rockingham residence?
Yes.
And to the best of your recollection, Ms. Simpson, what time was it when you got back to Rockingham?
Around 6 o'clock, between 5:30 and 6 o'clock.
5:30 and 6 o'clock on Monday, June 13th, is that correct?
Yes.
And so we have the time context. You had left at about what time in the morning to leave to go to your friend's house?
Between 8 and 8:30.
All right. Before you came back to the house at 5:30 or 6 o'clock in the evening, had you become aware that your dad was back in town?
Yes.
Sustained.
Did you become aware that your dad was back in town?
Overruled.
Yes.
And how did you become aware of that?
Through TV.
You saw it on TV?
Yes.
What did you see on TV?
Overruled.
I saw my father walking into the house.
And so when you saw that, you knew he was back, is that right?
Yes.
Did you have occasion that day or that afternoon to have still another conversation with your dad before you went back to Rockingham?
Yes.
Where was he at that time, if you know, at the time of this conversation?
He was at his office.
That's whereabouts is that office?
In Brentwood off of San Vicente.
And during that conversation, again, you can't tell us about the content of that conversation, but with regard to his demeanor, can you describe how he appeared to you as you talked to him on the phone during this conversation, in the afternoon hours, I guess, June 13th, 1994?
He was very quiet. Just still upset, but just there weren't a lot of words said on his part, but on my part. He was just very emotional.
All right. Had you ever seen him so emotional before?
No.
Conversation?
Never.
All right. And after that conversation, about what time was that conversation?
Between 4 and 5.
All right. After that conversation, within an hour or so, you came back home, is that correct?
Yes.
Were you aware that he would be coming home at around that time?
Yes.
And was that based upon some discussions you had had with him?
Sustained.
Okay. Did you know what time your dad was going to be coming back home?
Yes.
And did you try to time your arrival so you get back about the same time he did?
Sustained.
All right. How did you time your arrival and getting back home?
To what was said on through our conversation.
All right. Okay, I want you to describe for the court and jury again what you saw when you arrived back in Rockingham.
There were a lot of police cars, media, a lot of commotion, just a lot of people in front and inside the house, in the grounds of the house.
All right. Now, when you left in the morning hours, sometime maybe at around 8 or shortly after 8 o'clock, did you see many police cars around at that point, if you recall?
Yes.
How many, do you have an estimate? Can you think back and give us an estimate how many police cars you saw even as early as 8 o'clock in the morning?
Oh.
One or two.
All right. Characterize that with the number you saw when you came back 5:30 or after 5:30 in the evening?
There had to be more, like 4 or 5.
All right. Were you allowed to come on the premises at that time?
No.
When you got there, tell us what happened.
When I got there, I attempted to go through the gate, and the police officer told me that I wasn't allowed to go in and that he would find out when I could go in.
So, uniformed police officer?
Yes.
All right. Then what happened after that?
He left and then came back, and he told me I could go in.
All right, so then you came inside the residence?
Yes.
And where'd you go at that point?
I went into the house. I went through into the kitchen and then into the TV room.
All right, now when you got inside the TV room, did you see some people therein?
Yes.
Okay, and now, so we're clear, what time was this approximately?
6:30.
All right, and when you got in there in the TV room, which you previously described, would you describe for the jury again whom you saw there?
I saw my father, I saw my grandmother, my Aunt Shirley, and some of my dad's friends.
All right, and your Aunt Shirley is your brother's sister?
Yes.
Is that correct? She stepped out of the courtroom now.
Yes.
And your grandmother is whom, Miss Eunice Simpson?
Yes.
And you saw some friends in and around there?
Yes.
Now, this is the first time you saw your dad, is that right, that day?
Yes.
Can you describe for the jury how your dad appeared to you when you saw him there?
He was very motionless. He was numb. He was quiet, just sitting on the couch. He was holding my grandmother's hand. I walked over to him and I hugged him and I asked him if he was okay. And he just kind of looked at me, and I was just trying to comfort him because I didn't know what else to do.
It's a tough time for you.
Yeah.
You're sitting on the couch close to his mother?
Yeah.
They were holding hands?
Yes.
Was he talking to his mother at all?
Yes.
Where were these friends of his at that point, if you recall?
Sitting around in the TV room and over at the bar area.
And where was Miss Shirley Baker, his sister?
She was in the TV room too.
Were the TVs on at that point?
Yes.
Now, after you got there, were there other friends who came by? After your arrival, did somebody arrive after, or friends arrive after you got there?
Yes.
Do you remember any of the names of anybody who came by that evening?
Joe Stellini, Ron Shipp, Ron Fishman, my aunt Carmelita.
That's Carmelita Durio?
Yes.
And she arrived at some point?
Yes.
All right. Anybody else?
I believe that's it.
Do you remember at some point that evening that Carmelita's husband came?
Yes.
What's his name?
Charles.
All right. And what about your Aunt Shirley's husband? Was he there at any time?
Yes.
And what's his name?
Benny.
At some point that evening, did you see them?
Yes.
So many of the family members came, is that correct?
Yes.
Do you remember seeing Ron Shipp there?
Yes.
And I want you to describe for the court and jury, did you know Ron Shipp before this time?
Yes.
How did you know him?
Through my father. He would come by the house periodically.
When he came by the house, what would you see him doing, if anything?
Playing tennis or in the jacuzzi.
All right. Now, you saw him this particular evening?
Yes.
And when you saw him, what was he doing, if anything?
He was sitting at the bar.
And was he doing anything at the bar while sitting there?
Yes.
What was that?
Yeah, he was having a drink.
All right. Did you see him have one drink or more than one drink or what?
I saw him have at least one drink.
All right. What was he drinking, if you recall?
A beer.
Did you talk to him at all?
Yes.
You had a conversation with him?
A short conversation with him.
What did he say to you, if anything?
He just came over to comfort me.
All right. And did you say much to him or anything to him?
Just, you know, thank you and we're going to get through this. How are you doing?
All right, now,
Did he remain at all times in the same area that you saw him in when you first saw him that evening?
Yes.
And where was that?
The bar area.
All right. That's a little bit off the area where the family room is that correct?
Yes.
Now, did you continue to stay in the family room with the rest of the family?
Off and on, yes.
With regard to Ship, did you ever see him leave or move from that area while you were still there, the area of the bar?
No.
He remained there?
Yes.
And how long, from the first time you saw him to the time you last saw him that evening, did he remain in the bar area?
Maybe a little more, an hour. Maybe a little over an hour.
Do you know if he had been drinking when he arrived there that day?
No.
Were you able to tell whether or not he appeared intoxicated or not intoxicated, or how did he appear?
I couldn't say.
All right. You just saw him with the one beer, is that right?
Yes.
Now, was he a close friend of your father, if you know?
Yeah.
And was he somebody you'd seen over there?
Sometimes, yes.
Now, had you seen him over at the house within the week or so previous to this, Mr. Ship?
Yes.
He'd never been out to dinner with your dad, though, had he?
Not to my knowledge, no.
If you know. Now, with regard to this time that you'd seen him over at the house before that, describe what you saw him doing, if anything. This the week before?
Yes.
This incident? What did you observe, if anything?
He was playing tennis, and then later on in that evening, he was in the jacuzzi.
Was he with anybody else in the jacuzzi? Was anybody else in the jacuzzi with him?
Yes.
Who was that?
A lady.
Describe her for us.
She was tall, blonde, like dirty blonde.
And now describe for us, was this in the evening?
Yes.
And what was he, they were just sitting in the jacuzzi?
Yeah.
Was he drinking at all at that point?
Yes.
What was he drinking, if you know?
A beer.
Did you talk to him at that point?
Yes.
How close did you get to him and this particular lady?
I was standing right over at the jacuzzi.
And you had a conversation?
Yes.
Were you able to ascertain whether or not he appeared to be intoxicated at that point?
No.
All right, this conversation that you had with him, how long did it last?
5 minutes.
Did you talk to the lady?
Yes.
Do you know whether or not your father was home at that time when he was using the jacuzzi with this lady?
Yes.
Was your father at home?
Yes.
Did you ever see your father out there in the jacuzzi area where he was?
No.
Have just a moment, Chair.
Second.
Now, going back to the family room where everybody was gathered after you came back in the house, how long did you stay in the family room before you had occasion to go some other place, if you recall?
Maybe 20 minutes.
And by what time was it? Would it be by that time? What time would it be?
Between 7:30 and 8.
And then where'd you go?
To my room, to the kitchen.
All right. So you'd go in other parts of the house?
Yes.
Then would you come back in?
Yes.
All right. And so off and on, you leave the room and you come back in. Is
Is that right?
Yes.
And what time did you last see your dad that evening? If you know, approximately what time was it?
After 8 o'clock.
And when you saw him the last time, did he leave the room or did you leave the room?
He left the room.
You were still there when he left the room?
Yes.
And you described for us before that he'd been sitting on the couch holding his mother's hand,
yes.
Right? When you came back in at a time before he left the room, where was he seated and who was he seated with at that time?
He was seated with my grandmother, my Aunt Shirley, Bob Kardashian was there, and some of his friends were coming and going at that time.
So he's still basically in the family room, is that correct?
Yes.
Now, with regard to his demeanor and how he appeared, did he describe again for the jury how he appeared as before he left the room to go some other place? How did he appear to you then?
He was just very upset. He was crying off and on. We were watching the news, and he kept talking to the TV, saying, I can't believe this.
Sustained.
Sorry.
Can't tell us what he said to the TV.
Sorry.
But would he make statements?
Yes.
You could hear those statements?
Yes.
Describe his demeanor as he made those statements.
In shock, upset, in disbelief, just emotional, just.
And again, have you ever seen him this way before in your life?
No.
All right, so you saw him in this this condition, and tell us what occurred when he prepared to leave at that point.
He was tired, and it was suggested that he go upstairs and lie down.
All right, and when he left the room, did he leave with anyone at that point?
Yes.
And who did he leave with at that point?
Bob Kardashian.
All right, you saw he and Bob leave?
Yes.
Did you see either one of your aunts go with them?
Yes.
And which aunt went with them?
My Aunt Shirley.
All right. And as they left the room, in which direction did they go?
Towards the front of the house.
All right, did you go with them at that point?
No.
All right. So you saw Kardashian and your Aunt Shirley leave, and they left out of your sight, is that correct?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Yes, sorry.
Are the bedrooms of that house located upstairs, up some stairs?
Yes.
Is the carpet very, very light, almost white at that time?
Sustained.
Right. At that date, back on June 13th, 1994, what color was the carpeting on the stairs and going up the stairs into your father's bedroom?
White.
And the carpet in his bedroom was what color?
Like an off-white.
You came in that doorway that morning, let those police officers in after turning the alarm off. Did you ever see any blood spots in the foyer area of that residence?
No.
You were out and around the driveway area that day, were you?
Yes.
Did you ever see any blood spots in the driveway area?
No.
So, did you remain in the family room after your father had left?
No.
Where did you go?
I was in and out the house, my room, the kitchen, upstairs.
All right. You were there when your father left, and then you had occasion to leave that area yourself, is that right?
Yes.
After your father left, and with your aunt and with Bob Kardashian, was Ron Shipp still in that bar area?
Yes.
He still had a beer before him at that point?
I believe so.
You were still there?
Pardon me?
You were still downstairs there?
Yes.
Did you ever see him leave?
No.
So he was still there when you left, is that correct?
Yes.
Now, ultimately that night, did you go back to your room?
Yes.
You know about what time that was?
Around between 10 and 11.
And before going to your room, did you have occasion to ever go upstairs to your dad's room that night at all?
Yes.
And when was that you went upstairs to your dad's room?
Shortly after he had gone upstairs, and then before I went to my room.
You went up to see your dad?
Yes.
When you got upstairs, describe for the court and jury what you saw when you got upstairs.
He was lying down, and my Aunt Shirley was putting a face towel, cold face towel, over his forehead.
And he was lying in his bed?
Yes.
So you saw Ms. Shirley Baker in the bedroom?
Yes.
All right. You see anyone else up there at that point?
My Uncle Benny, Ron Fishman.
Is he a doctor?
Yes.
All right. And your Uncle Benny is married to?